Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our Wednesday morning devotion on the third week of Advent. Our morning devotion continues with the opening sentence on page 33. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship be a witness to your peace and saving power. Through your goodness, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Divinity. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands molded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he himself is our God. We are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. If only you will hear his voice today, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with truth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And so, brothers and sisters, we are at this point where we bear our souls to the Lord, bringing to Him even those things of which our consciences are afraid. Lord, we pray to You for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In Your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by Your Spirit, that we may live and serve You in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of Your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which You have made known to us in Your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with You in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our appointed psalm is 119, verses 49 to 72, beginning on page 630. Remember Your word to Your servant, because You have given me hope. This is my comfort in my trouble, that Your promise gives me life. The proud have derided me cruelly, but I have not turned from Your law. When I remember Your judgments of old, O Lord, I take great comfort. I am filled with a burning rage because of the wicked who forsake Your law. Your statutes have been like a song to me wherever I live as a stranger. I remember Your name in the night, O Lord, and dwell upon Your law. This is how it has been with me, because I have kept Your commandments. You only are my portion, O Lord. I have promised to keep Your words. I entreat You with all my heart, be merciful to me according to Your promise. I have considered my ways and turned my feet towards Your decrees. I hasten and do not tarry. I keep Your commandments. Do the cords of the wicked entangle me? I do not forget Your law. At midnight I will rise and give You thanks because of Your righteous judgment. I am a companion of all who fear You and those who keep Your commandments. The earth, O Lord, is full of Your love. Instruct me in Your statutes. O Lord, You have dealt graciously with Your servant according to Your word. Teach me discernment and knowledge, for I believed in Your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep Your word. You are good, and You bring forth good. Instruct me in Your statutes. The proud have smeared me with lies, but I will keep Your commandments with my whole heart. Their heart is gross and fat, but my delight is in Your law. It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn Your statutes. The law of Your mouth is dear to me than 1,000 in gold and silver. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. A reading from the word of the Lord, written in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, beginning at verse 8 and on to 17. The Lord sent a word against Jacob, and it fell on Israel. And all the people knew it, Ephraim and the inhabitants of Samaria. But in pride and arrogance of heart, they said, "The bricks have fallen, but we'll build with dressed stones. The sycamore has been cut down, but we'll put cedar in their place." So the Lord raised adversaries against them and stirred up their enemies, the Arameans on the east and the Philistines on the west. And they destroyed Israel with open mouth. For all this, his anger has not turned away. His hand is stretched out still. The people did not turn to him who struck them, or seek the Lord of hosts. So the Lord cut off from Israel head and tail, palm branch and reed in one day, elders and dignitaries at the head, and prophets who teach lies at the tail. For those who led the people, led them astray, and those who were led by them were left in confusion. This is why the Lord did not have pity on their young people, or compassion on their orphans and widows. For everyone was godless and evildoers, and every mouth spoke folly. For all this, his anger has not turned away. His hands is stretched out still. This is the word of the Lord. We continue on page 40 with the Benedictus. Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel. You have come to your people and set them free. You have raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of your servant David. Through your holy prophets, you promise of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our forebears and to remember your holy covenant. This was the oath you swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship you without fear, holy and righteous before you all the days of our lives. A new child shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare the way, to give God's people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sin. In the tender compassion of God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine upon those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Our second reading, written in the book of Mark, chapter 1, beginning at verse 1 and unto 8. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as is written in the prophet Isaiah. See, I'm sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John the baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people in Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed in camel hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And so, brothers and sisters, I'm grateful for the opportunity to share my thoughts on the gospel reading. I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I baptize you with water, but He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The words of John the Baptist. Our gospel reading today marks the ushering in of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. For us Christians, this good news is the expectant and imminent coming of the kingdom of God. In the season of Advent, we look forward to celebrating the first coming, the infant, and we prepare ourselves to and focus on the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The gospel reading points us to the prophecy concerning the herald, the forerunner, who will go before the appearance of the Messiah. The text refers to the prophet Isaiah, who foretold of the one who was being sent as a messenger ahead of the Messiah, who was to prepare the way. The one whose voice was heard crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Isaiah 40, verse 3. The prophet Malachi also spoke of the forerunner. It states, "See, I'm sending my messenger to prepare the way before me. And the Lord, whom you seek, will suddenly come to his temple." Both Isaiah and Malachi prophesied concerning the messenger who would precede the Messiah, that he would urge the people into moral and spiritual preparedness for his coming. It was John the Baptist who fulfilled this prophecy. He cried out in the desert, warning and urging the multitude to prepare for the Lord's coming. John lived in the wilderness, in close proximity to the River Jordan, where Jesus himself was baptized. He proclaimed and offered to the people from Judea countryside a baptism of repentance, seeking forgiveness of sins. His message was unambiguous. It was simple, that the people should turn away from their sins in order to receive remission. Without this, they would not have been prepared. They would not have been ready or able to appreciate the Son of God and the teachings and message that he would bring. John's water baptism was therefore preparatory in anticipation for the coming of the Messiah. As we reflect on this, it is a good time for us to truly search ourselves deeply so as to ascertain our readiness. The scripture said that the people from the whole of Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. John's call was for the people to turn from their godless ways and receive forgiveness, which can only come from God. When those who heard accepted his teaching, accepted his warning for repentance, John baptized them. This was their outward expression of their spiritual change. This baptism also separated them spiritually from the mass of unbelievers who continued in their godless ways, forsaking the Lord. On the other hand, the baptism united them with others that repented, the remnant who kept their faith and were ready to receive Christ. My friends, these signs and the readings and this reading should cause us to reflect on our own baptism and how it brought us into the fold. Our baptism separated us from those who have not as yet accepted Christ, and it has united us with those incorporated into the kingdom of God. What a blessing! Even further, in our baptism, God unites us with Christ, adopts us as his children, and makes us members of Christ's body, the church, and inheritors of the kingdom of God. We can ask no more. John's baptism could be considered as a foreshadowing of the baptism which Christ was to bring, and which was to come as he indicated later. The reading described John's attire on examination. He was clothed for the environment, the wilderness where he lived. The camel's hair and the leather belt provided protection and girding, which he required. Wild locusts and honey satisfied his nutritional needs. Sometimes we are not so concerned with what is required, but what we lust and crave, and go beyond our requirements, stretch ourselves to get things that we do not really need. John's needs may seem primary or even primitive, but John did not intend to draw attention to himself, but to the one of whom he was the forerunner. John's sole purpose was to draw attention to Christ. John seemed to have a tunnel vision concerning his task and the Messiah. This was borne out in his proclamation when he said, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thongs of his sandal." One can hardly get more humble than that. John's role was also as a servant to the one who is coming to serve. John's role was a servant to God's servant for all mankind. John was indeed very careful to make the distinction between his water baptism of repentance to that of the baptism of Christ. John said, "I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." To my mind, John was indicating that it is the baptism of Christ which would produce the inflow of spiritual power, as Acts 1:8 confirms. Also, it would serve to incorporate all believers into the church, which is the body of Christ, as mentioned at 1 Corinthians 12:13. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we journey into Advent, we could focus a bit more on our baptism and what it has done for us, what it brings us, what it provides for us. My brothers and sisters in Christ, in the gospel reading, John's baptism prepared the people for the coming of the Messiah. In this Advent season, John directs our thoughts to the Lord, whose birth we are eager to celebrate, for whose second coming we prepare and we anticipate, and in whose reign throughout eternity we live in hope to partake. May the Lord be with you. Let us now confess our faith as we say together the Apostles' Creed on page 42. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. By way of intercession, we pray for the world gripped in this virus, and we hope that the protocols and the vaccine which is being distributed would go in a long way in bringing an end to the suffering of death and death in the various parts of the world and in our country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the Anglican Church worldwide, for the well-being of the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby. We pray in our province for the Archbishop Howard Gregory and for our diocesan Bishop Claude Berkeley and for the retired bishops Calvin, Roland Clive, and we hope that they will be inspired to continue God's work. May God continue to bless them. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, today we pray for St. Clement's Naparima, for the Reverend Father Errol Inchinali. We pray for UTT College, Teachers Training College in Corinth. In our diocese, we pray for the Reverend Father Professor Anderson Maxwell, for his assistants, Reverend Father Titus Akbarali. We pray for the deacons Finley, Fanfare, and Pontiflex. Also for the laity, remembering our former rector, Canon Gemmett Hazelwood. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring before God the five congregations in our parish, Oropoon, St. Philip's, the Church of the Transfiguration, St. Aidan's, and St. Mary's, remembering those who are sick and praying fervently that they would use their downtime, that we would use our downtime to draw closer to God, not only seeking healing and forgiveness, but seeking for his guidance and for his protection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for citizens abroad, and we hope that they will all return in good health. We pray for those who have passed, and pray that God would enfold them. We continue with Suffrage C on page 44. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall not hope in vain. The collect is for the third Sunday in Advent. Third Sunday of Advent. Stir up your power, O Lord, and with great might come among us. And because we are sorely hindered by our sin, let your bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Page 45. Into your hands we commend ourselves this day. Let your presence greet us this close. Strengthen us to remember that in whatever good works we do, we are serving you. Give us a diligent and watchful spirit, that we may seek in everything to know your will and in it may gladly perform it, to the honor and the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our path, a strength to our lives. Please take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. My friends, our service has ended. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.